Okay, so let me just start by reminding you of the helium-4 phase diagram. So, roughly speaking, we have pressure up this axis and temperature along this axis with, let us say, 5K somewhere around here and 30 atmospheres somewhere here. And then you have a phase diagram where at high pressures you get the solid. At low temperatures, at low pressures, you get the liquid and gas, and there's a very critical point here. So far, nothing special. The interesting point about the phase diagram of helium is that you have the so-called lambda line, which comes down roughly like so. And on this side, the helium is in normal phase, behaves pretty much like any other liquid. And on this side, we call it superfluid. This is, in fact, actually, let me write slightly different notation for that. The more common notation is that this is the so-called helium-1 phase and is nothing special. Here is the helium-2 phase, and that is the one which shows the various anomalous properties. And incidentally, yeah, the solid is mostly HCP in crystal structure. There is a small sliver of BCC up here, but this actually occurs at temperatures higher than we're going to be interested in. So I'm going to forget about that. And I'll treat the solid as always being HCP. The phenomena we're going to be talking about, crudely speaking, occur in a region below about 2 degrees absolute, so somewhere down around here, and at pressures anywhere from the melting curve up to something like 60 atmospheres or so. So this is the region we're going to be basically talking about mostly in this lecture. Let's first of all a few general references. The only one among these references which I'd really recommend as a sort of general review and introduction to the subject is the Balibar one. The others are quite useful, but they're rather specific in orientation. The Balibar one really does cover much of what I'm going to be talking about in today's lecture. I guess hopefully this will be posted, so I'm not quite sure in exactly what form, but it will be posted, so you don't have to worry too much about taking everything down right now. Okay, let's start with some prehistory. It was clear from about 1938 onwards that the properties of the so-called helium-2 phase, the low temperature phase of the liquid, were very anomalous. Nowadays, it's normally simply referred to as superfluid, but I think one should bear in mind that superfluidity really refers not to a single phenomenon, but to a whole complex of phenomena. This is something I think which is often obscured in many of the textbook discussions and so forth. As we'll see, it really isn't one phenomenon which you can identify as superfluidity. It's a complex. These various phenomena often go together, but there's no, as far as I know, there's no a priori reason why they always have to. So as I say, from 1938 onwards, people realized that something very strange was going on in the helium-2 phase, superfluid phase of liquid helium. And in 1941, Landau wrote a very famous paper in which he produced a two-fluid, so-called two-fluid model of helium-2. And the general idea is that the liquid is supposed to consist of two different components with densities which are temperature dependent. So you have a so-called normal component and a superfluid component. Together, they, let's see, do I have a, yes, this is, together, the two densities sum to the total density. However, they are temperature dependent individually. So the normal normal density is essentially the, it approaches the total density when T goes to the lambda temperature, that's the temperature of this line here, and goes to zero for temperature going to zero. You might have to get yourself a chair. Yeah. Landau's basic idea was that the normal component would behave like any other liquid, whereas the superfluid component has a special property of behaving irrotationally. In other words, its velocity, Vs, satisfies curl Vs equal to zero. That, of course, is not a kind of condition which is satisfied by the ordinary velocity, the ordinary fluid velocity of an ordinary liquid. It's very special to helium 2. The total mass current is simply the sum of the normal density times the normal velocity, the velocity of the normal component. And as I say, there's nothing special about the velocity of the normal component. That's pretty much like the fluid velocity of an ordinary liquid, and then plus rho s vs. Okay, well, inspired by Landau's ideas, Andrew Nikashvili in 1947 performed a very famous experiment. And this, as far as I know, was the first torsional oscillator experiment performed on helium. Nowadays, we'll see that torsional oscillators are basically two a penny, but this was a pioneering experiment. What he did was he set up a cell. You have a cell here containing helium, and then he inserted into that a set of closely spaced plates, which were supported by on a torsion fiber here. So the plates basically can rotate uniformly as the torsion fiber twists. The spacing between the plates was sufficiently close that the viscous penetration depth is much smaller than the viscous penetration depth. And what that means is that if you were to do this experiment, say, with just to pretend for the moment that helium was just like water, then what would happen is that as the torsional fiber oscillates and the plates oscillate backwards and forwards, the liquid between the plates would be completely dragged with the plates themselves. And indeed, if you do the experiment above the lambda temperature in the helium 1 phase, it looks as if that's exactly what happens. If you work out the period of the oscillator, and if you observe the period of the oscillator, and from that work out the effective moment of inertia, it is consistent with the idea that the moment of inertia comes not only from the plates themselves, but also from the helium, which is being dragged along with the plates. So now, what's special about this in the helium 2 case is that if you believe Landau, then the rotation of the plates cannot drag the superfluid component with it. Because remember that the superfluid has to satisfy the condition that the curl of its velocity is zero. Okay, so it can't drag the superfluid into rotation, and therefore the moment of inertia of course has a contribution from the plates themselves, but as regards the helium, it has a contribution only from the normal component. And since the oscillation frequency is proportional to the inverse half power of the moment of inertia, that should, so the moment of inertia should decrease below the lambda temperature, the oscillation frequency should increase, and from that one should be able to infer the superfluid density, strictly the normal density, but then from that the superfluid density. Okay, let me just stop for a moment here, because this is really, this experiment is the grandfather of just about all, or most of the experiments which have been done on supersolids in the last 8 years. So so let me make quite sure that is clear what's going on there. I think the concept is relatively simple. say the you simply use the fact that the observed oscillation frequency is proportional to I to the minus a half. So by measuring this, you measure this. You know what the contribution to the moment of inertia of the plates is, and that's presumably not changing. So from it, you deduce the contribution which the helium is making. And then according to the two-fluid model, that gives you a measure of the normal density, and therefore of the superfluid density. Okay, any, let me stop and ask if there are any questions or comments about that. This is really rather essential to understand this, because this is basically at the foundation of everything that's been done over the last few years. Okay. Now, of course, there are many subsequent developments in the theory and experiment on liquid helium, but there's one particular experiment which is particularly important in this context, and that was done by Hess and Fairbank quite some time after Andrew Nikashvili's original experiment in 1967. What they did was, incidentally, I should just comment about one thing about the Andrew Nikashvili experiment. As we'll see later, there is a particular characteristic angular velocity, or for that matter, character in any particular geometry, there is a characteristic angular velocity, which very crudely speaking, corresponds to the velocity you'd have to attain to introduce a single vortex. So the question arises, in the Andrew Nikashvili experiment, was the characteristic angular velocity with which the one has to be very careful here. It's very easy to get confused about the various frequencies coming in. If I recall correctly, the actual frequency omega of the actual oscillations backwards and forwards in the Andrew Nikashvili experiment was something like a kilohertz, which is similar to what it has been in the experiments I'm going to be talking about in the last few years on the solid. However, you could also ask, what is the maximum angular velocity which is attained during the periodic motion? That's quite different quantity. Generally speaking, it's very, very much less than 1 kilohertz. To avoid confusion, it's probably better to talk about the maximum velocity with which the plates actually move. And compare that with a particular characteristic velocity, which, as I say, is the characteristic velocity at which a vortex will enter. Now, the crucial point to note about the Andrew Nikashvili experiment is that the characteristic velocity of the plates during most of the cycle is always much greater than this characteristic quantum velocity, as it were. That's a point we're going to have to come back to and emphasize later. Okay, so now the point about the Hess-Fairbank experiment was two things. First of all the rotations which go on in the Hess-Fairbank experiment, in the language I just used, the maximum velocity of the bucket as it rotates is now less than this characteristic quantum unit. Velocity. That's the whole point of the Hess-Fairbank experiment. So, in other words, So, in other words, what you're going to do is this: you start off above the lambda temperature. Sorry, this should be lambda, not C, my mistake. Start off above the lambda temperature. So, up here, say somewhere, and you rotate the bucket. But now, essentially, this isn't quite an exact description of the Hess-Fairbank experiment, but for practical purposes it is. Essentially, you rotate the bucket DC. That is, you impose a constant rotation on it. As I say, a slight oversimplification, but the important point is you're not doing it at a kilohertz. Any oscillations which are taking place are at frequencies very, very much lower than one kilohertz. So it's essentially a DC rotation that you're imposing. What happens when you do that? Well, I have to tell you, I am a theoretical physicist, but I have done one experiment. The experiment I have done consists of taking an old-fashioned gramophone turntable and putting a glass of water on it, in the center, and setting the turntable into rotation. Well, what do we expect to happen? Well, initially, of course, the water is at rest, but after something of the order of a minute, typically, it'll come into rotation with the turntable, and you can actually verify this by, say, decorating the surface of the water, or perhaps looking at the meniscus, or whatever. So, okay, we're all used to this. When we turn off the rotation, of course, after a minute or so, the water will come back to rest. So it does work. And that's exactly what happens to helium above the lambda line here. So it behaves just like water, effectively. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to continue to rotate the bucket, but we're going to cool the liquid across the lambda line here into the helium 2 phase. And lo and behold, what we actually find happens is that the liquid, as viewed from the laboratory frame, ceases to rotate. And that is, it progressively comes out of rotation with the container. And as we cool down towards zero temperature, it will apparently have stopped in the laboratory frame. Do we actually believe that? Not quite. The general belief, for which there's some supporting experimental evidence, is that if you were to do this experiment at the North Pole, where life gets relatively simple, then in fact the helium would not be stationary in the frame of the terrestrial laboratory. It would be stationary in the frame of the fixed stars. As I say, although that's not proved, the experiments are consistent with that hypothesis. So I think it's crucial to realize that this is not the same experiment as the Andrew Nikashvili experiment. And we'll, in the next lecture, we'll come back into some detail and discuss the precise difference between them. But anyway, I shall refer to this then as the Hess-Fairbank experiment. We'll have to refer back to it later in the context of the solid. Okay, so all of this is, both these experiments, both Andrew Nikashvili and Hess-Fairbank, are in good agreement with the general theory of superfluidity in the liquid helium-2 phase. Around 1969 or 1970, various people, more or less independently, I think, started to wonder about the possibility that a crystalline solid might show, at least to some extent, the same kind of behavior. Now, at first sight, this seems very, very unlikely, because after all, if something is going to be superfluid, then presumably it has to be fluid, in other words, liquid. So, is it really reasonable to think that a solid should show it? Well, for one or two reasons, people believe that it might be. And the most obvious candidate for such behavior was solid helium-4. Why helium-4? Well, of course, it's the same physical system as forms the liquid. In particular, the helium-4 atoms still obey both statistics, whether they're in the liquid or the solid. Secondly, if this is some kind of quantum effect, you ought to try to choose the system, the best system you know, where, as it were, quantum effects are most important. And we certainly know that, for example, as regards the question of freezing and so on, helium is much, much better than, say, heavier rare gases like neon or argon and so forth. So it did seem that solid helium-4 would be the place to look. In particular, it was, this is my paper in 1970, which I'll come back to later. What I was able to show was, first of all, that if this were the case, then you should see behavior similar to what you saw for the liquid in the Hess-Fairbank experiment. And I christened that behavior, since it didn't have an agreed name at the time, I christened that property non-classical rotational inertia. So remember that non-classical rotational inertia is the property of coming out of equilibrium with the bucket when the bucket is rotating sufficiently slowly. Now, as we'll see, unfortunately, perhaps unfortunately, the phrase NCRI has become widely used in recent literature in a rather broader sense. But that was the definition I originally gave it way back in 1970. I should say, to be accurate, you don't in fact observe this directly at the Hess-Fairbank experiment. What you observe is the change in angular momentum of the bucket. Because from conservation of total angular momentum, the angular momentum lost by the liquid has to be gained by the bucket. And this is something you can actually detect. Okay, so so following these theoretical suggestions, incidentally, I should just mention, because though we will come back to this in the next lecture. Sorry, this should be actually be Andreev, not Andrew. Andreev, they're both Russian authors. Andreev and Lifshitz, the way they got to the conclusion was to assume that the phenomenon of so-called Bose-Einstein condensation, which is believed to be at the root of superfluidity in the liquid helium-4, might actually occur in the solid. And the way that it might occur is that you've got a non-zero concentration, let us say, of vacancies, and these vacancies, not the atoms themselves, but rather the vacancies, underwent Bose condensation. And then, from then on, they believed you could analyze things roughly as you would for the liquid phase. My own work didn't actually make that specific assumption. It's a more general approach, and we'll come back to that later. Okay, so following this theoretical work, in the period roughly between 1970 and 2004, there were a number of unsuccessful attempts to observe NCRI in solid helium-4. Once or twice people thought they'd observed it, but then they went back and looked at the data more closely, and it looked as if what they're actually seeing is some rather weird behavior associated with dislocations in the solid. And that is a topic, again, which we're going to have to come back to in more detail. However, in 2004, there are a couple of papers by Kim and Chan at Penn State University, which claimed the possible observation of supersolidity in both helium-4 in Vicor. Vicor, incidentally, is a commercial glass which has large numbers of narrow pores in it. And these you can pour, you can insert helium into these pores and examine its behavior. They claimed evidence for supersolidity, both for helium-4 in Vicor and later, slightly later, in bulk solid helium-4. So this really was the crucial paper, or the crucial pair of papers, which really set off the excitement in this area. So we have to talk a little about what we mean by supersolidity. What we mean by a supersolid, crudely speaking, is a system which simultaneously exhibits crystalline order and superfluidity. Okay, let's just take a look at those two concepts briefly. What we mean by crystalline order is that when we take the static, the equilibrium static density, and expand it in a Fourier series, then there exist non-zero values of K in the Fourier transform. These are what are usually called the reciprocal lattice vectors, for which this Fourier transform does not go to zero in the limit of infinite volume. Okay, this is just, in some sense, one's normal intuitive definition of what you mean by a crystalline order. What about superfluidity? Well, the trouble is that, as I say, people tend to think of superfluidity as a single phenomenon, but it really isn't. It's a complex of phenomena. And so, in some sense, that part of the definition is always a little vague, but it should at least, if it's to be genuine, total superfluidity, it should include the behavior seen both in the Anderson-Cashvili experiment and also in the Hess-Fairbank experiment. And in particular, it should show the phenomenon which I originally christened NCRI, that is this coming out of rotation with the boundary condition, coming out of equilibrium with the boundary conditions. However, I think it's fair to say that some of the implicit definitions of supersolidity in the recent literature are less stringent than this. For example, I think some people would say, well, if you do see the Anderson-Cashvili experiment effect, but don't see the Hess-Fairbank effect, that still counts as superfluidity. That I think is, well, it's really a matter of convention and definition, but it is something you have to bear in mind when reading the literature, unfortunately. Now, one very important point, it is implicit here that the crystalline order has to be intrinsic, that it cannot be imposed by an external periodic potential. You see, if in fact you allowed the case of you allowed a case in which you got periodicity and at the same time superfluidity, well, okay, maybe one can't think of a straight example of that, but at least in the case of superconductivity, which is a very closely related phenomenon, that's sort of trivial, because after all, remember, in a typical superconductor, you've got an underlying ionic crystal lattice. So you would expect that the electron density does have a certain periodicity in this lattice, right? At the same time, the electrons may well be superconducting. You don't count that as anything to do with supersolidity. I mean, that would be a trivial effect, okay? So for example, in the case of helium, we know that thin films of helium on graphite do show non-classical rotational inertia, and at the same time obviously they have some kind of periodic structure. However, by itself that doesn't count as supersolidity. What might count as supersolidity, in fact should count as supersolidity, is if you got an ordering of the helium atoms with a periodicity which is not directly imposed by the substrate itself, but is, as it were, chosen in some sense more arbitrary, like the so-called 4/7 phase, which is conjectured for the second layer of helium on graphite. And if that were then superfluid, then you would call it a genuine supersolid. That's a slightly more complicated situation, and I won't talk about that except tangentially. So, as of today, as far as I know, at least, evidence is claimed for supersolidity in, first of all, in bulk solid helium-4, secondly, for solid helium-4 in the pores of Vicor glass, and thirdly, as we just mentioned, for the second layer of helium-4 on graphoil. There are also a lot of theoretical speculations regarding the supersolidity of ultra-cold gases in optical lattices. Graphoil. Okay, graphoil is simply a particular form of graphite. I think you have to do something very nasty to it. You have to sort of pump it up so that it explodes, and so you separate out the layers a lot. It's related to graphene. Yes, in some sense you could say it's a sort of more or less three-dimensional collection of graphene sheets. Yes. As I say, there are a lot of speculations regarding supersolidity of ultra-cold gases and optical lattices. Again, it would only be genuine supersolidity if the system itself managed to break a symmetry other than the underlying lattice symmetry. And there are all sorts of cases which theorists have analysed where it might do that. So that's the... incidentally, one thing I meant to investigate but get round to before this lecture is how far there have been searches for supersolidity in elements other than helium. I strongly suspect that people have looked for it, for example, in solid deuterium or even solid hydrogen, but I don't have that information right now. In any case, if they did look for it, they certainly haven't found it, that's for sure. So really, it turns out that the subject of supersolidity raises two major questions. First of all, are the experiments which I'm going to describe seeing genuine supersolidity or just very anomalous kinetics? I mean, either would be interesting, but really supersolidity would be even more interesting than this. Secondly, is the effect characteristic of a pure crystal lattice, or does it depend on the presence of dislocations and grain boundaries and things like that? Again, it would be, in some sense, even more interesting if it were characteristic of the pure crystal lattice. Okay, so now let's start discussing the experiments in a bit more detail. Most of the experiments since 2004, looking for supersolidity, have been torsional oscillator experiments. And the general principle involved is precisely what it was in the original Andronikashvili experiments. So you have some kind of apparatus which has roughly cylindrical symmetry. It's hung up on a torsion fiber. You drive it through capacitive coupling to a drive electrode, you pick you detect its rotation by a second electrode here. The important bit of the apparatus is this flange here, and viewed from above, of course, there are various. I think it's obvious there have to be certain connections, which I haven't shown here. I'm just showing the essential part of the apparatus. It's basically an annulus into which you try to introduce solid helium. And a very important modification is that you may or may not choose to plug the annulus, that is to block it with some kind of substance which is impervious to the helium here. And that's, as we'll see, a very important control experiment. So the general principle then is that the oscillation frequency is given by the torsion constant divided by the total moment of inertia to the 1/2 power. The total moment of inertia is equal to the moment of inertia coming from the rest of the cell, that is all the solid bits and so forth, plus the moment of inertia of the helium. And then, so prima facie, what you expect is that the inertia, moment of inertia of the helium is given by the normal phase value, whatever value it had in the normal phase, times rho n over rho, where rho n over rho is the normal fraction. Okay. As I say prima facie, because as you will see, there are other possible complications that come in. Okay, so these now are real data reproduced from the original paper of Kim and Chan. What they saw was that below about 0.2 degrees absolute, the frequency of their torsional oscillator increases. Now, the absolute increase is tiny. It's something of the order of a part per million. And the only reason that they can actually see such a small change in the resonance frequency, of course, is that the actual Q factor of the oscillator is extremely high. It's something like, typically in these experiments, it might be anything from 10 to the 7 up even to perhaps to 10 to the 9, I guess. So these are really incredibly undamped oscillators. And that, because of this, you can actually see very small shifts in frequency. Now, of course, you have to interpret that in terms of NCRI, you have to know what the original contribution of the helium in the normal phase was. Well, when I say in the normal phase, I mean a temperature's high enough that none of this is going on. Okay? And the way they do that is quite simply that they just compare the oscillation frequency of the system when the cell is empty and when it's filled with helium. And they interpret the difference in terms of the difference of the moment of inertia, which they attribute to the helium. So interpreting the data in that way, they infer a so-called NCRI fraction. I'm going to abbreviate this later as NCRIF for fraction. NCRIF, rho n over rho, which at zero temperature is about 2%. So here we are. I'm just trying to read this graph. As you see, if you... what they're actually plotting here is not the frequency, but its inverse, the period of oscillation. And you'll see that remember, the overall period is about a millisecond, since you're working at a kilohertz. Okay? The change is only of the order of a nanosecond here. Nevertheless, they can pick it up. So that's the basic phenomenon there. A very interesting aspect of this, which was seen in the very earliest experiments, is that the effect does saturate with velocity. I don't know if you can read this, but crudely speaking, this is the lowest velocity here. And as I increase the velocity, I still get the effect, but it dies off until at high enough velocities, this is 420 microns per second, it dies off completely and you have no more effect. Now, of course, Kim and Chan, the moment they saw this effect, rush off and publish it, because they clearly realized that there were all sorts of spurious effects which they might be imitating genuine NCRI. So the first control experiment is that no effect, anything like this, was seen for the empty cell. nor for that matter, for the cell filled with solid helium-3. And that is at least good prima facie evidence that it can't be due to a modification of the torsion constant. Because after all, that modification presumably would be much the same for the empty cell. So if it were, if you were seeing an effect which is simply due to that, then you would expect to see a frequency shift also for the empty cell, and they don't. There is a complication which we'll come back to there. A second very crucial observation, which has been repeated by others, is that the insertion of the plug in the circuit reduces the effect almost to zero. And that washes out, at least at first sight, that washes out a second rather obvious conjecture, namely that there is indeed a change in the moment of inertia, but it's simply due to redistribution of the density for one reason or another. Okay. You see, let's go back for a moment to the geometry. Oh, sorry. Yeah. You see, if we put the plug in, then any density redistribution should be pretty much unaffected by that, presumably. So it does look as if the effect is essentially dependent on the fact that the ring is connected as a whole here. And that's a very, very crucial point, I think, about all these, the whole experimental situation here. Now, since the original Kim Chan experiment, the basic effect has been replicated in at least 9 other labs. So there seems no doubt that the experiments, the data are for real there. However, typically, these labs do all operate under much the same experimental conditions. In particular, the resonance frequency is always of the order of 1 kilohertz, although it can be varied somewhat around that, as we'll see. The characteristic velocity, which is h bar, this is this funny quantum unit of velocity, as it were, h bar of Atmar, is always about a few microns per second in these experiments. Again, that's a figure worth holding in your mind, if you can. Okay, well, we now have a fairly good understanding of the systematic behavior of this frequency shift effect. Normally, the results are expressed in terms of the NCRIF, non-classical rotational inertia fraction, F, which you would infer. Now, remember that F is essentially the value of rho S over rho, the superfluid part, relative to the total density at zero temperature. The first observation is that F, as defined in this way, is very sensitive to the preparation of the sample, extremely sensitive. In particular, people have done experiments with quenched samples where they cooled, took the liquid and pressurized it very quickly. And in those experiments, one can see values of F right up to about 20%. Remember, the original experiments only showed about 2%. So this is considerably larger. On the other hand, if you anneal the sample carefully, you can get F down to something of the order of 0.02%. However, it's interesting that these experiments really are pretty accurate, and F never seems to vanish within the error bars. So F does always seem to be non-zero, even for the most carefully annealed sample, but maybe very tiny. Second point is that F is very sensitive to a helium-3 impurity. And in fact, rather surprisingly, it turns out that the introducing helium-3 impurity tends to increase the effect, contrary to what we might first have guessed. Now, you should ignore most of this graph because it has to do with a different experiment, but just look at the open circles here. This is with the red open circles are for 0.3 parts per million of helium-3. That's basically the natural abundance of helium-3. If I just if I just get a commercial sample of helium-4, then it will contain about 0.3 parts per million. So that's the this curve here. Now if I deliberately try to purify my helium-4 and get rid of all the helium-3 that I can, so I go down to 1 part per billion of helium-3. That's the black dots. And you see now the effect has is only occurring. I mean, it occurs with essentially the same magnitude at low temperatures, but it occurs at a much lower temperature. Notice, incidentally, this axis is plotted logarithmically here. So there's a big difference between the two. So that's behavior does seem to have been replicated in just about all experiments which have looked at it, that more helium-3 means a better NCRI effect. Finally, people have looked the original experiments and others have looked at the pressure dependence, and that interesting is non-monotonic, and it peaks somewhere around 40 bars, so around there. But there seems, but as far as we know, the effect, well, you still see traces of it way up at something like 100 bars. After that, I guess it usually becomes rather too small to observe. Okay, now one can try to analyze the temperature and amplitude dependence of the effect a little more carefully. A nice paper by the Cornell group, this is Seamus Davis's group, in Science in 2001, where they do very detailed torsional oscillator experiments. And they define what they call chi of omega and t. It's basically a response. It's the relationship of the maximum angular displacement to the drive amplitude. Now, because this is, in general, is a non-linear relation, this is not quite equal to d theta by d gamma. But for the moment, let's pretend it was. Pretend we can forget about the non-linearities. If we do that, then it turns out that chi to the minus 1, this is a theoretical result, it's just equal to k minus I0 omega squared, where I0 is the moment of inertia of the empty cell. There's a damping term, which is due to the torsion of fiber, etc. And finally, this is the interesting bit, you have the inverse chi of the helium itself. So you can read off. Basically, this means that you can, from the raw data, you can read off, this should be chi helium, I guess, here. You read off chi helium as a function of temperature at the resonance frequency. And now, one of the things you always have to remember here is that although all the data, the whole data, as it were, is the change, or at least very, very largely the change in the resonance frequency, it really isn't changing very much. I mean, you started at 1 kHz, roughly, and you're ending up at 1 kHz plus one extra part in 10 to the 6 or something of the kind. So this is really a pretty fixed number here, omega 0. Suppose that chi actually turns out, this is just a theoretical assumption for the moment. Suppose it has the Debye form, like this. Then one can infer what the tor, so in other words, what is this? What is this form? Well, this is basically the form of response which you're given when all that a system does, the typical response of a system, which when you perturb it, doesn't do anything particularly exciting, but just relaxes towards its new equilibrium value with at a rate equal to the inverse of some relaxation time tor here. Very common model for all sorts of phenomena in liquid and solid physics. So let's just make that assumption for the sake of argument. Ask what we can infer then. You can actually measure experimentally the imaginary part of chi. Now, how does that measure? Now, I didn't actually stress this much so far, but the frequency shift is not the only piece of data you have. You also do have a change in change in dissipation as a function of temperature, and so forth. So if you look at the dissipation, which measures the imaginary part of chi to the minus 1, we already saw the frequency shift measures the real part of chi to the minus 1. So you can now read off tor as a function of temperature directly from the data. Now, in fact, it turns out that the data don't fit too well a simple Debye analysis. Let's just pretend they did, and pretend that analysis still implies for a large drive amplitude, but tau is now allowed to be a function of velocity as well as temperature. So this is a bit of a phenomenological ansatz, if you like. It's not not obviously going to be true, but let's just see what will happen if we do assume it to be true. Then we can read off from the data the change in the relaxation time, not just as a function of temperature, but also as a function of the root mean square velocity of the oscillating cell. And a very striking result that comes out from these experiments. It looks as if the data are excellently described by assuming that the relaxation rate, that is the inverse of tau, is simply the sum of two terms, one of which depends on temperature, the other of which depends on velocity. And both of these have characteristic power law dependencies. This one has an exponent here, which is 2.75 plus or minus 0.1. This one has an exponent, which is minus 1.117 plus or minus this. I think that this should be zeta. In fact, these two numbers are consistent for a ratio of zeta to lambda, which is 5/2 within, still keep within the error bars here. So, as far as I know, no one has the faintest idea what the origin of this behavior is. It's very striking, very reproducible, but it's been around now for a bit over a year, I guess, and still no one really knows what on earth to do with this. It's very striking. One rather interesting further observation is the dependence of the NCRI effect on the path length in a torsional oscillator. Now, this is an interesting modification of the experiment because you see, in the original experiments, you just had this simple annular geometry. Crudely speaking, when you go once around the ring, you come back to yourself. Kim et al., that's the PSU group and others, did a modified experiment in which the helium was actually contained in this annular fiber, which was wound in this way. So now you see that you have to go many times around the axis of the oscillator to get back to your original position. In other words, the path length to get back to the total length of your closed path is very much larger than what it was in the original experiments. It's a very interesting modification. And depending on the path length, they found that the NCRIF, the NCRI fraction, decreases as a function of path length. And in fact, for the two larger paths, it appears to be consistent with zero. This is actually quite puzzling because early experiments which had the simple geometry did in fact have path lengths which were sort of comparable. They were 4 centimeters and they found considerably larger NCRI fractions. A further puzzle is that in this geometry you don't appear to see extra dissipation for any value of the path length. Again, very, very puzzling. No one quite knows what's going on here. Okay, there are quite a few experiments which don't involve torsional oscillators, and probably the most important of these, and certainly the one which has aroused most discussion in the literature, is the measurement of the shear modulus. Now, there are some experiments, in particular the ones I was just discussing from Cornell, where the shear modulus, regarded as a function of temperature and velocity, appears to correlate extremely well with the NCRIF fraction. Here you are, you see, this is a graph of the, this is actually a graph of the NCRI fraction plotted, its scale, so as to be plotted both as a function of temperature and of velocity on the same graph. The original experiments, which were Day and Beamish way back in 2007, actually measured the shear modulus of a sample of helium-4, which was not in any kind of torsional oscillator geometry. You know, it's just there on the lab bench, as it were. And they found anomalies which appear to correlate rather nicely, at least as a function of temperature, with the NCRI fraction. And now, this data of Pratt et al., which is more recent, has gone even further. They've shown that even regarded as a function of velocity, the two curves look essentially indistinguishable. Here's the NCRI fraction. Here is the shear modulus. You see there's essentially very, very small discrepancies between them. And that was actually very worrying when it was first noticed, because what it suggested is that the effect may have actually nothing to do with a change in the moment inertia at all. It might have to do rather with a change in the force constant. Because remember, and this is a rather tricky point. Remember that one always thinks of the apparatus as, including the fill line, as being essentially completely rigid. But in fact, you do have this fill line coming down through your tube, and that contains solid helium. And if the properties of the solid helium change, that could actually change the force constant. Admittedly, the change would not be large, but then one's not talking about large effects here. So this was really rather worrying, and there were a number of papers that came out at that time claiming that really the whole idea of NCRI is complete nonsense, because nothing's really happening to the moment of inertia. It's just the torsion constant that's changing. Now, I mean, admittedly, even if that were true, that wouldn't mean it wasn't interesting, but it would affect the significance rather substantially. So I think one does have a fair number of arguments against that. First of all, we get a similar change in the shear modulus at around the same temperature, also in solid helium 3, but in that case, no NCRI effect is observed. Secondly, the stiffening effect on K shouldn't occur for helium 4 in capillaries in Vicor, and nevertheless they do show an NCRI effect. Thirdly, there's a second experiment, sort of tailor-made to examine this point, which finds very different velocity dependencies of the NCRI fraction and the shear modulus. They still agree that the temperature dependence is essentially the same, but the dependence on velocity is quite different. And finally, very interesting experiment done very recently on the effect of DC rotation. If I impose a steady rotation and then do my AC oscillator experiment, apparently the DC rotation does affect the NCRI fraction quite substantially, but it does not affect the shear modulus, which can be measured independently in these experiments. So that makes it look improbable that the whole effect is due to this. I'll come back to that in the next lecture in slightly more detail. Second set of non-torsional oscillator experiments is mass transport through the solid. Now the first few initial experiments which looked for mass transport through the solid had a negative result, but slightly more recently Rand Hallock, I guess that's at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, did a rather neat experiment as follows. They exploited the fact that this freezing pressure of helium in Vicor is actually very much larger than the freezing pressure of bulk helium. So what they did was to construct an apparatus of this type where they put the whole thing under a pressure between the freezing pressure of the bulk helium and the freezing pressure of the Vicor. So here we have liquid in the Vicor. Now the helium is liquid, and in the bulk it's solid. And so what they did basically was to increase the pressure on one of these two tubes and look for any effect occurring in the second tube. Presumably, if you did get an effect, what that would indicate is that you had a certain amount of mass flow from the liquid through the solid back into this liquid here. And they did indeed find a non-zero result. What they find is they do indeed find a non-zero relaxation, and if they work out the mass flow they can work out a mass flow which would be necessary to produce that relaxation, and if they assume that the whole volume conducts, then what they actually obtain is an expression for the product of the NCRI fraction and the critical velocity of the liquid, that is the maximum velocity at which the solid can sustain superflow, and it comes out to be this number here. Now you see, if you were to put in values of F of the order of the ones which are normally observed, which is say 1% and so forth, then you get something like 2.5. Well, actually, you get a rather small number for the critical velocity here. In fact, the number you get for the critical velocity would not appear to be have anything much to do with the velocities at which you start to see nonlinear effects in the torsional oscillator experiment. So it's not entirely clear that even if this is right, it's really quite the same phenomenon which is going on. One should also notice that there is a certain amount of controversy in the interpretation of the raw data. Basically, the group of Sebastian Balibar in Paris and the group of John Beanish in Alberta and one or two others are rather tend to look at their results and other people's results in terms of changes in the shear modulus and so forth. And so there's been a back and forward of argument between them and the authors of this experiment as to whether the interpretation of the raw data is actually correct. One thing that is clear is that if you simply do an experiment to look for the flow of solid helium-4 under a pressure head, say through a small aperture, that appears to give negative results, at least it has so far. Rather different kind of experiments. People mentioned the possibility of fluctuations. If fluctuations are important at the onset of this behavior, and in particular, if this behavior, if the weird behavior that you're seeing in solid helium-4 below about 0.2 K, if that actually corresponds to a genuine phase transition, then almost certainly you should see some kind of thermal signature of that. And if it's a second order phase transition, which seems the most natural and obvious conjecture, then you should see a peak in the specific heat. Well, do you? Well, yes, you do. But really, I haven't plotted the data here. When you do plot the data, the vast majority of the observed specific heat is simply the Debye TQ background, which people have known about for 50, 60 years. Okay? If you look very carefully, you can see superimposed on that a small extra bump. I think we couldn't really even call it a peak. It's just a bump in the specific heat data. Which is so small, in fact, that it's not surprising that it was overlooked in the experiments of the last 60 years. One really does have to look very, very carefully to see that. It is there, however. It does appear to be reproducible. It increases with increasing disorder, and interestingly, it appears to be insensitive to the helium-3 content. So, again, that's a puzzle. No one really knows quite what to make of that. The final experiment.
That's
a good question. If it were a first order phase transition, then generally speaking, such phase transitions involve a non-trivial latent heat, and it seems a bit difficult to believe that that would not have been noticed in the last 60 years of experiments on solid helium. I don't think the argument is any better than that. But anyway, the current experiments do seem to suggest it's at least it's not first order. Whether or not it corresponds to a transition at all is anyone's guess. Yeah. Neutron scattering. This is an experiment really of a rather different nature and with a rather different purpose. This experiment is really not looking for supersolidity as such. Rather, it's looking for the possible presence of Bose-Einstein condensation in the solid. And the reason why it's looking for that is that in the liquid, at least, there's a very strong association between superfluidity and Bose-Einstein condensation. Well, Henry Glyde and his group have done neutron scattering experiments down to about 65 millik, and they find that the condensate fraction is zero within the error bars, and the maximum tolerable value would be 0.3%. So that's not particularly definitive, but almost certainly those experiments are capable of improvement. So hopefully within a few more years, they'll be able to say something which is non-trivial about the the degree of Bose condensation in the solid. Yeah, I have a couple more view graphs. The reason this bit comes at the end is that the exciting bit has really only come in the last couple of months, and so I didn't get round to looking at it until quite recently. Okay, so this is the effect of DC rotation. So people have these rotating cryostats, and they're able to actually put a torsional oscillator inside the rotating cryostat. So now they can impose, you see, a DC rotation plus an AC rotation. And generally speaking, turns out, I mean, typically in these experiments, the DC velocity of the flat, the rim is large compared to the extra bit imposed by the AC rotation. So that's something to bear in mind when thinking about these experiments. So here is a experimental graph of the dependence of the NCRI fraction on the DC, the imposed DC velocity. So this is just the velocity of the linear velocity associated with the rotation, DC rotation. You see that now, in the case of the NCRI fraction, it never goes away, but it is quite sensitive. It is depressed quite strongly when I increase the DC rotational velocity. That in itself is an interesting point. A second really interesting point is they also managed to measure the shear modulus under the same conditions. That has absolutely no effect from the rotation. That, I think, is a major argument against the hypothesis that that all you're seeing is really a change in the torsional constants. Very recently, this is this paper, which is I think only about a month old here, they actually observed a periodicity in omega with a periodicity about 0.17 radians per second. Again, that turns out to be very large compared to the characteristic quantum unit of rotation. So what is happening as a function of the DC rotation doesn't seem to have much prima facie to do with this quantum unit of rotation, and that's quite puzzling for the side. You think if there were an effect, it should somehow be associated with that, but it doesn't seem to be. Okay, so that basically concludes my account of the experimental data. I'm sorry if it does seem a bit like a laundry list, but you know, there have been a lot of experiments, and it's nice to be able to see exactly what has and has not been done. One thing you might notice, which has not even been attempted so far, is the literal analog of the Hess-Fairbank experiment with the solid. That is, you put the thing in a, well, you could put it as well, put it in an annular geometry, it doesn't matter. You rotate very slowly at high temperatures, and very slowly, meaning slow compared to this characteristic quantum unit of rotation. Okay, and then you cool down through the relevant temperature region and see if the system comes out of equilibrium with the rotating container. That experiment would be really, I think, a crunch experiment, but for all sorts of good experimental reasons, it's just extremely difficult. No one has even attempted it so far. Okay, so that's the state of play. Now, so I haven't even begun, really, to talk about possible theoretical interpretations, and that will be the subject of the next lecture. Well, thank you.